Telerad slash Google series of webinars for CBRS. We are still waiting for people to join in. It's been on to the series of CBRS series of webinars that Telerad has been doing for quite a while. Today is together with one of our SaaS partners, Google. Rob Ketcher will be presenting slides for the next set of interesting questions. If you don't have Pell, what's next? As you know, CBRS has been an interesting topic that's been going on for the past couple of years. It's finally live. Lots of anxiety. My name is Alex Freilichman. I'm VP of Sales at Telerad Networks. We will try to keep this conversation interactive. So please send your questions through the chat. All lines are muted. We will try to pick them up through the presentation, as well as leave a little bit of time towards the very end to answer them as well. So on that note, Rob, would you like me to go through this to do the screen share, or you would like to do it yourself?
I'm not 100% sure whether I'm able to share in my current mode here on the webinar, Alex. So why don't you just go ahead and present the slides, and then I'll just talk. Yep. Okay. Good. Well, thank you very much, Alex and team, for inviting me here. Thank you, everyone who's joined. We really appreciate you coming out. I want to spend some time talking today about PALS, priority access licenses. And now that the auction is complete, I'll give a little bit of a run through about the results, spend some time on how PALS actually work, and then what does it all mean for you if you don't have a PAL. Okay, let's go to the next slide. So I always like starting off these conversations with setting some context for Google's role in CBRS. So why are we here? What are we doing? So I'm in a small group within Google that is chartered with creating wireless abundance. And that's, as many of you have probably heard me say before, that's a fancy way for saying better internet for more people in more places. And that's been focused in the U.S. primarily around dense urban areas where demand has outstripped supply. And we see MNOs and MVNOs deploying, intending to deploy to help address that issue using CBRS in rural broadband underserved areas where broadband just tends to lag behind. That's where a lot of you are active with CBRS now and expect to be even more in the future. And with CBRS, we also believe that this is a way to help stimulate cellular innovation and really lower the friction for deploying networks. Okay, next slide. So that's a bit about who we are, and then what do we do in CBRS? We're a technology provider to the ecosystem. So we operate a spectrum access system, which manages fundamental access to spectrum. We have a network planner that you can think of it kind of like Google Earth, but with network planning built in. So powerful network planner right in a browser. And then we also offer CPI training. Okay, enough about us. Next slide. Let's talk about the PAL results. So as many of you have likely seen, over 90% of licenses were sold. It was sold for over $4.5 billion. So a very successful PAL auction on by most accounts. And one takeaway from that is you can expect in most places that you're going to operate, you can expect that all the PALs will be taken, or at least vast majority of the PALs will be have been purchased. Okay, and this small plug for SashaJavid.com has some great stats on PAL. All the PAL auction results are public, and you can download it. You can download a big CSV of county by county and see who bought licenses in your county, which I encourage you to do because I think that can be insightful. But let's flip to the next slide, and we're going to take a look at a few, just a kind of a smattering of PAL winners, just to understand some different approaches that some of the PAL bidders took. So the first, let's take a look at DISH. DISH, for all intents and purposes, just bought a nationwide network. They spent right around $1 billion, and they have just under 2 licenses per county. And there's pretty much every county that was out there. They liked all counties. Flip to the next slide. Now that's very different from someone like Verizon. Verizon, who spent close to $2 billion on the auction, they went very deep in the most densely populated counties. And in those counties, they purchased close to 4 licenses per county. So very, very concentrated and focused approach. Next slide. And then you have players like Comcast and Charter, which took an approach similar to Verizon, where they were going deeper in the markets where they're present, only a limited number of markets. And then you have there are a lot of regional purchases of licenses, and I'm just showing Nextlink here as an example of one of the larger PAL winners that went regional. But of course, they're just purchasing where they're operating or intend to operate. Okay, next slide. So now let's dig in a little bit to how PALs actually work. And this slide, this works a lot better when it builds, and unfortunately we weren't able to get a kind of a buildable version in here, so I'll talk you through it, so just bear with me. One of the key things to keep in mind is just because a PAL was purchased in your county or all PALs were purchased in your county, that doesn't mean that those licenses or those channels are completely off limits. For a PAL holder to receive PAL protection, they need to deploy. And the way it works is, suppose you have 2 operators in the same county, operator A and operator B, and they're both using channel 1. Now, they're both operating on channel 1, and let's suppose operator A is the PAL holder. When they deploy with their PAL license, they'll get a PPA. The SaaS admins will define a PAL protection area, a PPA, around their CBSDs. It's called a cluster of CBSDs. And that defines the protection area. Now, if you're outside that protection area, you can operate on that on channel 1 to your heart's content. You're not affected by the PPA. And likewise, you can also enter the PPA, the PAL protection area, and operate on different channels. So if you're operator B, you can continue operating on your channel 1 outside the PPA, as well as operating on channel 2 and 3 inside of it. Additionally, PALs can be sublicensed through a secondary market. Those are just starting to take shape now, but we expect those to be healthy markets and to be supported by all the SaaS admins. Okay, next slide. Now, one thing this does mean, since all the PALs were purchased, and assuming that PALs eventually get deployed, the GAA. A GAA spectrum is really important to get the most out of it. And there does happen to be more GAA spectrum. There's 80 megahertz of GAA and there's 70 megahertz of PAL. And one of the reasons Google is hands-on with our technology in this industry is we believe that we have a unique set of capabilities that can maximize spectrum for everyone involved. And that's, we know where the clutter is. We have very, very high res geodata. We have a best of breed propagation engine that can run in the cloud. And in fact, we just launched our latest version, our next gen propagation engine, which we call G-Wave, which is very relevant for the fixed wireless market. Okay, so flip to the next slide. Let's just dig into this a little bit further. As many of you know, let's suppose you have three networks. If you're a SaaS administrator and you're trying to allocate spectrum in the GAA and allow different networks to coexist with each other, you have to model the interference between the radios. And you do that using a propagation model. So suppose we have three networks. Flip to the next slide. Now, if you don't know where any of the clutter is, you're going to assume that everyone interferes with everyone else. And you would have to limit the power and the spectrum that that these networks could use. So in this scenario, if you assume they all three interfere with each other, they're going to be limited to 50 megahertz apiece out of 150. Flip to the next slide. But as you all know, trees and buildings get in the way and they block radio signals. They provide isolation for networks. And so if you know where those trees and buildings are, you can recognize that these networks are all isolated from each other and do not interfere with each other. And flip to the next slide. And they can actually all operate at 150 megahertz. So you really want to know where the buildings and the trees are and the hills and you want to know where the clutter is. So flip to the next slide. It's also not just about knowing where the clutter is. It's about what propagation model you use. So here's three different models. The ITM model, the hybrid model, and an R clutter aware model, Google's clutter aware model. Now, for context, the hybrid model is used by all SaaS administrators to calculate PPA protection and GWPZ protection, so protection for existing Part 90 licenses as well as PAL protection. And all SaaS admins use the ITM model for all other protection, things like dynamic protect DPAs, you know, naval activity on the coast, FSS, et cetera. So Google's clutter aware model, we know where the clutter is and we have a great propagation engine on top. We can actually deliver 10 times the amount of predicted spectrum using that model. Okay, next slide. And that's what would be available in the GAA with Google. So what does all this mean? I'd say there's kind of three main takeaways here. Number one, in the GAA, there's more spectrum available. You're gonna have 80 megahertz available versus 70, especially as grandfather license continue to expire. Additionally, there's another 70 megahertz from PAL when it's not used. A lot of these deployers, if you look at Dish, who's kind of just getting started, even the big MNOs, MSOs, those deployments, they're going to take time. They're not an immediate day one kind of thing. And that means that that spectrum is available to you. Will be available to you until then, and also if you're operating out in kind of more rural, less populated areas, those are areas where those larger players, the MNOs and MSOs, may not go. And lastly, Google SaaS, because of our high-res geo data, because of our propagation engine and the fact that we can compute that all in the cloud, we can maximize GAA spectrum for everyone involved. And we're working very closely with Telrad to help get that type of spectrum maximization to each of you. Okay, and with that, I'm gonna open up to questions because I imagine there's plenty of questions around PALs, how they work, results, etc.
Awesome. Thank you, Rob. Group would like to remind all lines are muted. You're welcome to submit your questions through through the GoToWebinar interface, and we'll be answering them as they come. Rob, so in other words, to recap what you're saying, until PAL is owner is actually running the base station and utilizing the spectrum, that spectrum technically still available under GAA. That's the bottom line, and that's basically the lesson learned for everybody.
That's correct. And it, to be specific, the device actually has to, well, it registers first with the SAS, and then has to start heartbeating on a grant within 7 days. So when the device registers, this is getting a little, you know, kind of techie geeky, but, you know, nuts and bolts of how things operate. But when a device registers with a SAS, the PPA will start immediately after CPAS. And CPAS is the nightly exchange between all the SAS administrators of CBSD information. So the device registers on Monday. On Tuesday, it has PPA protection. And then it has 7 days to start heartbeating on a grant. And if it doesn't heartbeat on a grant within 7 days, it actually loses that protection.
Okay. We have an interesting question from Bernie. But what happens if I go with GAA and then PAL owner comes after the fact?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So if you're operating on a PAL channel and a PAL operator comes in, deploys in your area, that PAL operator will get priority. Your grant would get suspended, and you'd have to move to another channel, assuming that you're within the PPA or interfering with the PPA from outside.
All right. Bernie, so in other words, you're not wasting effort. You're simply going to have to request a different grant with a different channel and continue operating under the GAA spectrum. Now, it seems that there is some certain geography around. So if a PAL owner owns a county, but they're only operating mm-hmm. few towers within the county, what happens, let's say, 20, 30, 40 miles away from the tower? Can non-PAL service provider coexist and use same frequencies, same channels?
Yeah, and that was the diagram that I was showing at the when we were diving into a little bit about how PPAs work. You can absolutely be in the same county and yeah, maybe even want to flip back to it. It's a bit of a cluttered slide when you don't get the build, but I think you guys get the picture. You can absolutely be operating in the, flip back another slide, Alex. One more after this. Yeah, here we go. So here we have a scenario where you have two operators, and suppose operator A is the PAL holder, like we went through last time. You can be operator B and still be in the county, still operating on the same PAL channel, but as long as you're outside that PPA contour, you'll be just fine. Okay. Now we will provide in our spectrum availability, and this is all accessible via our SAS portal. You'll be able to see the impact of channels in your area. So if you're considering a deployment, you could look at spectrum availability for that point and see if there's impact from a PPA. Of course, we won't tell you exactly where the PAL deployer has deployed. You won't be able to physically see the PPA contour, but you will get that information in spectrum availability. Okay, so one really key thing here is that you want to do your homework, right? As you're thinking about deploying, pull the data for who bought PALs in your county. You'll actually soon be able to see what channels they've been assigned. So PALs will be assigned a specific channel That process is underway right now. PAL holders have not been assigned channels. They will be assigned channels, and that should be a swap period where they'll be able to trade the channels. But all that'll get worked out so that come in February, PAL owners can start deploying with PPA protection. And at that point, their channels are quote unquote locked. So you'll know which channels are, kind of quote unquote latent PAL, meaning a PAL holder could deploy on that channel. And then you can take a look at who the PAL holders are in your county and make decisions for yourself about whether you want to deploy on that channel. Maybe it's a utility company that bought a PAL in your area, and you can, imagine where they might deploy. again, just make more intelligent decisions about your frequency plan.
Thank you, Rob. One more question from Brad. And that's actually quite interesting. So how do you coordinate the allocations made with your model with other SaaS providers? Because we understand that each SaaS admin using different propagation models, right? So your results may go for more packed spectrum, more users, better frequency reuse, right? And how does it work with other SaaS admins?
Yeah, it's a great question. So first of all, in terms of incumbent protection, we're all using the exact same models, right? We're using the ITM model, we're using the hybrid model, and that's for protecting incumbents, be they incumbents and higher tiers, so including PAL holders, right? PPAs run from the hybrid model. Now, when it comes to our clutter-aware model, that applies to the GAA and then applies to Google's own coexistence predictions and channel recommendations. So number one, we'll maximize spectrum for everybody in the area, irrespective of whether they're on the more people that are on Google SaaS, the more spectrum we can squeeze out of the available GAA. It's better to have let's say you had four deployers, three of them were on Google and one wasn't, you still get more spectrum at the end of the day using Google's model. But it's better if they were all on it. So maybe I'll address your question less theoretical and a little bit more practical, how it's working right now. So when there's an interference issue, right now the resolution of interference, as Alex knows well, that interference resolution is a pretty manual process right now, where the interference is reported to the SaaS administrators. We can provide a channel recommendation for both parties, irrespective of whether they're on our spectrum access system or not. As long as we have the main information we would need is their grouping information, their channel grouping and interference group, and then we can provide a report that says here's the frequency plan that'll get the most out of GAA for both parties. So it is manual. We'd like to get it to be more automated and have even the SaaS administrators exchanging that CCG and ICG information, the grouping information, and have those plans the channel recommendations more automatically implemented. But for now, it's pretty manual.
And to
I hope that answers the question.
To complement what you just said, Rob, the CCG, ICG, there is a concept of grouping that SaaS administrators use to understand if this is the base station, all subscriber units are attached to that particular sector. So if a base station changes the channel, all those CPEs will follow. So you wouldn't have to deal with each device individually. So within our BreezeView, as many of you are aware, BreezeView functions as a domain proxy server. And that piece of software will communicate or does communicate with Google and make sure that this grouping concept is maintained to simplify this process, what Rob just talked about. Question from Jason. Hello, Jason. What happens when more than one company is requesting the same GA channel? And I'll say more, Rob. Well, yeah. It's easy when it's the same Google. What if second GAA grant has been asked by another? And it's kind of closely related to some of the answer that you just did. But what happens if two operators running on two different service providers, SaaS administrators, and requesting same channel?
Yeah. Let's take a more simplified example first. So suppose you have two operators. Operator A is already deployed with another SaaS admin, and operator B comes along and is using Google and wants to deploy in the same area. When they go to deploy, they can take a look at channel recommendations within our SaaS portal. This is available to device manufacturers via the Spectrum inquiry. And you'll be able to see on a per channel basis, not only the impact from incumbents, but impact from other CBSDs. We'll be able to, we provide predicted noise from other CBSDs. So we know where that other CBSD is from that the first operator who's using another SaaS admin. We know the height, the azimuth, the power level, et cetera, et cetera. And we use that to predict noise that you would receive where you're deploying. So in the ideal world, you follow the channel guidance and you avoid that interference. Now, if there's literally no other channels available and you both, well, actually, maybe we'll flip it around now. Let's think about the flip side scenario. Suppose you deployed first with Google and someone else comes along and they don't have that type of channel guidance and they just grab onto the same channel that you're using. They ask for a grant, they get a grant, and they start transmitting. Well, you're going to get interference and you'll have interference in the GAA. And then we have to work that out between the two parties.
That means we are waiting for CPaaS, where interference will be recalculated and both service providers may get an adjustment to their powers. What does it mean?
Yeah, so you would report in this right now, the way it would work is you'd report interference. Someone's transmitting on a channel that you're using. That's going to come back to the SaaS admins. We can, of course, at that point, run a channel recommendation report for both parties. If the two parties are unwilling to use other channels and you're both set on using the same channel, well then there's going to have to be a reduction of power to the extent that it can be supported. Otherwise, you interfere with each other. So in some ways those are decisions between two operators. If you're both intent on using the same channel in the same area, you have to work things out to get to different channels, and we can provide all the data to get there, but we're not forcing, we're currently not forcing operators to one channel or another in the GAA. At some point, we expect to have a little bit more of a maybe direct, a little bit more control to be able to move operators off channels if needed, but at this point, we're making recommendations.
Mm-hmm. Question from Stacy. Hello, Stacy. Haven't talked to you in a while. Rob, an interesting question. So when Navy comes in and basically gets priority access to CBRS.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
Is Google offering and you have a user who's operating under GAA? Is Google when you suspend a channel, does Google offer an alternative where you jump over, where that service provider can jump over, where it's a manual process? How is it done?
Yeah, currently it is manual. You would see, again, in the channel recommendations, in the channel guidance, and this feature is actually in beta right now, and I really should have included a link where you can sign up for this beta. And you know what, I'll get this to Alex, and this is my fault for not including it, but you can sign up. We'd love for more people to get on the beta, start trying it out. But if your device is suspended, you can take a look at channel guidance, and you can see all the other channels that are available, and you can move over. And if that happens to be a group, assuming that this isn't just a single base station with a single CPE, and there's lots of CPE, then those can all be in what's called a CCGA, a common channel group. And we can make recommendations for the entire group to move over safely to a new channel.
Awesome. Thank you, Rob. Stacy, the good news, you are not within the DPA. Tennessee is too far inland, but networks in Virginia, North Carolina, South Carolina, some of the eastern networks in Georgia, and definitely Florida, they're definitely fall into that scenario. But for you, Stacy, that's just simply, not applicable. Another question from Jason: is there a way to handle companies that are not following FCC? Oh, that is actually phenomenal question, because we're already starting to, we're stepping into the territory right now, since Part 90 rules officially expired. All right, so now we are following Part 96, but there potentially may be some networks that still operate under Part 90. What happens? Is there enforcement mechanisms?
Yeah, that's a great question. So I'll say a couple things. Number one, the FCC's made it pretty clear that that companies need to transition over to CBRS. And that's important for everyone involved, so that SaaS administrators can provide guidance where devices are located, so that if you're getting hit with rogue interference, we don't know about it. Right? And we can't make any intelligent recommendations based on it, because it's just flying underneath our radar. So number one, companies do need to deploy. I think we also know there are companies who've not yet deployed, and companies may continue in that phase. Unfortunately, they are in violation of FCC if they haven't received a waiver. That can be reported to the FCC. And that's up to the FCC to enforce. None of the SaaS administrators are playing an enforcement role for rogue operators. That's not part of our purview, if you will.
Got it. But is there venues or mechanisms for people to report that? How does it work?
Yeah, I guess that would be like reporting any other. The CBRS won't be, I would imagine, would not be the first rogue deployment that many of you have dealt with. So it would be the same sort of operational procedures for reporting interference that would get reported to the FCC. And I don't, off the top of my head, know the exact procedure for that. I'm guessing you all know that better than I do, but I can look that up and follow up with Alex if that's helpful.
Awesome. Thank you. There is another question. Interesting, Rob. Stacy is clarifying. Stacy, let's do this. Let's take it offline. I don't have a good answer for that, but I believe it's only applicable for certain ships that use certain kind of radar, and this is a sea radar. It's not land-based radar. Let's take it offline, we'll be able to answer that question properly. All right. So
was the question about how many channels get taken up when?
No, if there is a military base, navy base nearby, but it's military base in inland, is it? Can it impact? Can it impact the amount of available spectrum in GAA?
Yeah, there are a very few limited number of land-based radars, and I don't know if they're operating from an actual military base, but they're static, meaning they're we know where they are, and you can view that in the SAS portal. You can look at spectrum availability. Those radar systems would also be covered by ESCs, but they're also kind of along. I believe they're along the border, so not necessarily deep inland. But I'll see if I can dig up a map on that as well.
Awesome, thank you, Rob. And. Group, I just shared a link for the beta program, SAS beta program, that Rob mentioned a little bit earlier today. You are welcome to sign up. It's g.co/spare spectrum/SAS beta. So you're welcome to sign up and test out the features that Rob was talking about. I'll leave that on the screen for a little bit. Rob, another very interesting question that often comes up is if you could talk a little bit more. If you do not have a PAL, but adjacent county does, and PAL owner has a tower near the county border, let's say a mile away. What happens with operator B, the one that is an adjacent county that does not have a PAL? How is it impacting his livelihood or their livelihood?
Across borders, across the county border, you could still be interfering with a PAL on the other side of the border. That's possible, right? Even if you're outside the actual PPA itself, if you've got a radio up high, pointed right at the PPA, and it's running at high power, and you're really close. And you would get all that information again via spectrum inquiry, channel guidance. And when you request the grant, your grant might be required to have lower power, or it might be suspended outright.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So even though the PPA itself, for clarity, even though the PPA itself stops at the county, you could still be interfering from the other side of the county.
So is there a distance that we should keep in mind in general?
I'm sorry, say again, Alex.
Is there a distance that we should keep in mind as a reference point? If you are deploying equipment near PAL owner, regardless if you are within county or outside county?
Yeah, it really depends on it depends on which way are you pointing, how high are you putting the radio, what's the down tilt. You know, there's so many factors that go into that it's hard to give a rough rule of thumb. So I think that most of the people on the line, you know, this is your business. You guys are intimately involved or know the details of this a lot, probably a lot better than I do. So, I think you can use your good judgment, you know, kind of planning ahead of time to know, if I'm near a county and I'm pointed right at the county line and, you know, I've got a big radio up high and right. I think you can use your judgment there. And again, you can also get guidance through the SAS portal.
Mm-hmm. Got it. All right. So SAS portal basically it becomes an important tool to make sure to request check spectrum availability, available channels, and so on.
Mm-hmm. That's right. You can view on the map both incumbent as well as just kind of general incumbent impact, and you can do point analysis. That will take into account other CBSDs as well.
Awesome. So for the group on this call, would like to kind of give a little bit better visual. So our domain proxy BreezeView is really executing certain aspects of management. Right, you can define the CBSD, the radio unit on both base stations and CPE. You can register, you can request a grant, obviously sign. There is quite a bit of information going as a metadata on the back end through the heartbeats, but Google, through the portal, brings layers and layers of extra features and capabilities. So don't look at it as BreezeView, the only venue for you to manage SaaS. There is a lot more coming in straight from the Google, and these two systems work together, coexist, and to be able to provide you best possible service and availability. Good stuff. I don't see any more questions from the group. So on that note, Rob, I think we're going to be wrapping up. Would like to appreciate your time and that you were able to carve out, you know, despite the technical challenges that pop up here and there, happened today. But we were able to make it. Thanks, everyone, for attending.
Oh, this is great.
Go ahead, Rob.
Yeah, I just wanted to also say thank you so much. Again, really appreciate it. And I hope this helps demystify a little bit PALs and PAL protection areas and give you all greater confidence in deploying. And feel free to reach out at any time if you guys have additional questions. Thank you again.
Awesome. Thank you. Thanks, everyone, for joining. And we will be sending a follow-up email with a webinar recording as well as Q&A. So any additional questions, feel free to reach out to us. Many of you know our contact information direct. If not, feel free to send emails to sales-na for North America at telrad.com, and we will take it from there and be able to answer it. Thanks very much for your time.